Hey, what's up everyone? This is Luke, and welcome back to our Intermediate Core Data video tutorial series. In this video, we'll look at creating your own mapping model, which Core Data will then use to perform a migration from an older version of your data model to the latest. Here's what the app will look like by the end of the video and challenge. You'll take an existing note-taking app and go from a note entity to having a note entity and an attachment entity for images. As I mentioned in the introduction, you've changed your data model a few times already if you've been following along with the previous videos. So far, you haven't had to worry about migrations at all. Even so, each time you've changed the data model, Core Data has inferred a mapping model and performed a lightweight migration for you behind the scenes. Instead of having Core Data infer it, you can manually create a mapping model. This contains the instructions to go from one version of the data model to another. This is what's known as performing a manual migration. If a manual migration isn't quite enough, you can also insert your own code into the migration process. This is what's known as a custom manual migration. The way you go about inserting your custom logic into the migration process is to subclass NSEntityMigrationPolicy and then point to the subclass from the mapping model. When the migration happens, Core Data will call methods on the subclass during each stage of the migration. You can override these methods to insert your own custom code. There are three stages to the migration process. First, Core Data sets up two managed object contexts, one for the source and one for the destination. For each entity, Core Data will copy each object and then move the attribute data over, ignoring validations at first. When all the entities and attribute data are in place, the second stage is to move the relationships over. And then the final stage is to run all of the validations and ensure the data store is in a consistent state. If you've written a custom entity migration policy, its overridden methods will be messaged at various points through this process so that it may help with the transition. This time, we're taking a look at a note-taking app called Uncloud Notes. As you can see, we have two notes here, one that has no image. It just has this sample text and a title, and then also a date. And this one also has an attached image. So right now we're modeling this data with our note entity. As you can see, it has a body, date created, display index, image, and title. Something you may not have seen before is this little arrow next to the data model file. If we drop it down, we can see there's actually two versions of our data model so far. One that we're currently using, and then an older one that doesn't have images. Our goal this time is to take the current data model and split these note objects out into a note object that has an image attached via a relationship with an attachment object. This way we can associate other metadata with our attached images and attach more than one image if we want. So far, each change you've made to your data model has been simple enough that you've been able to allow Core Data to perform a lightweight migration for you automatically. This time, you actually want to move all of your user's existing images from their current note entity to the new attachment entity, so that their data won't be lost when the app is updated. Since Core Data can't infer your intentions this time, we'll have to set up a new version of the data model and then create a mapping model that tells the system where to put the images. First, we can go ahead and create the third version of our data model by selecting it and then coming up to Editor and choosing Add Model Version. We'll just name it version 3. And then we'll base it on the current version too. Now we can update our entities in the new version of the schema without affecting the old version. First, we'll create the attachment entity. If we come to our current image, we can see that we have an image transformer set as the value transformer. We just need to make sure to bring that over to our new image. And then make sure the module is set to the current product module. Now we can go back and delete the old image. And then finally, we want to set up a relationship to connect our notes and attachments. And then we also want to make sure that our attachment relationship is set up to be a too-many relationship, not a too-one. And then finally, if we come to note, we can see that we have a name set for the class and a module set. So let's go ahead and make sure we have that for our attachment. The class will be attachment. And then the module will just be the current product module. Now that we've got our new version of the data set up, we need to make it the current version. As you can see, the little green check mark is currently on V2. To change this, we can just click on our data model, come to the file inspector, and then down here we have our current model version. So we can just change that to V3, and the check mark will move up here. So if we built and ran at this point, which we shouldn't, the app would now be using version 3 of the data model. If we did build and run, all of our current images would be lost in the transition, since we haven't yet told Core Data to take the images from the old notes and set them up as attachments. That's where our mapping model comes in. To create a new mapping model, all we have to do is do Command N or go up to File, New File. Come down to the Core Data section and choose Mapping Model. And here we choose the source data model. In this case, we'll choose version 2. And then the destination will be version 3. We'll just give it a slightly more interesting name. Call it Mapping Model V2 to V3. All right. So here we have what we call entity mappings. This one is attachment. We'll come back to that. But this one is notes. So we're taking notes in the old version of the model and transitioning them to notes in the new version of the model. And here you can see that we want body to be taken from the source's body value, date created from the source's date created. And these are all pretty basic. This is actually what happens whenever you let a lightweight migration run. These will automatically be created and run under the hood. Right now, the attachment entity mapping won't actually do anything. If we come over here to the far right, we can see that the source hasn't actually been selected yet. In our case, we want attachments to be generated from notes. So we can just set this to be note. And then Xcode will automatically change the name, and it'll even add a destination attribute for images and take them from the source image. So if we built and ran at this point, the attachment objects would exist, but there's not actually a relationship connecting them yet, which makes them kind of useless. To set up the relationship, you'll need to use a value expression with the existing note relationship mapping. The syntax for value expressions resembles Objective-C's message send syntax. Here we can see that we have our manager object. This is actually an NS migration manager object that's running the current migration under the hood. The second value is actually the method that we want to call on our manager object. Here we're calling destination instances for entity mapping named with source instances. So we're passing in an entity mapping named note to note, and then we're passing in source instances of our source object. The expression is basically saying, set the note relationship to whatever the source object for this mapping gets migrated to by the note to note mapping, which in this case will be the note entity in the new data store. The only thing that's still wrong about this mapping is that we really only want an attachment to be created if the source note actually had an image in the first place. To make this happen, we just need to add a simple expression to the filter predicate for the mapping. If we come in here, we can find the filter predicate right here. And this is just saying that we don't want to run this if there's no image. The last thing we need to do before running our app, which will trigger the migration, is fix a few spots in our code. First, we need to go to note.swift and update it to use attachments. And then we'll add a few computed properties for convenience. Here we have a computer property that just returns the latest attachment, and then we use it to get its image if it has one. Next, we need to go to Attach Photo View Controller and fix it. Here we're trying to assign the image that's chosen directly to the note. Let's go ahead and fix this to create a new attachment instead. Here we're creating a new attachment and then taking the chosen image and setting it as the attachment's image. Now that we've fixed our code, we can go ahead and build and run. So it looks like our image wasn't actually successfully brought over. Let's go check out our data model and see if we can figure out why. And when we come in here, we actually see that our note entity doesn't have an inverse setup for its relationship. Neither does the attachment. So to fix our problem, let's go ahead and set up an inverse. And we see that note is the inverse of attachments. Let's go ahead and build and run again and see if that fixed the problem. All right, looks like it did, and we successfully have moved our image to an attachment.
That's it for this video tutorial, and as always, we like to leave you with a challenge. In the demo, you saw how to create a custom mapping model to map one entity to two entities while keeping your user's data consistent. Your challenge this time is to take things a step further by creating another migration that not only requires a custom mapping model, but also requires you to implement your own NS Entity Migration Policy subclass. You'll find all the details, as well as a walkthrough, in the challenge document below. I hope you've enjoyed this video tutorial. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.